What was it that made you realise that Men Who Hate Women was an important book to write?
Well, the interesting thing is that I think as a woman online with an opinion, as a woman in politics, as a feminist woman, you will be aware, and I'm sure many women in our audience will be aware of these communities of men. But of course, I didn't write the book for 9 years, and the reason why was because although I began to investigate these men, because it was a complete shock, and who were these people sending me these things, and I started to build an awareness of this sort of murky online world that they inhabited, there was at the time a very powerful and often repeated argument, a sort of version of don't feed the trolls, which was that we shouldn't give these communities the oxygen of publicity. And at the time, I was sympathetic to that argument. So although I was extremely aware of these communities, I was in touch with them on a daily basis, hundreds of them, I didn't talk about this for the best part of a decade. What I did do was start going into schools and working with young people, partly because so many of our entries to the Everyday Sexism Project were from girls, schoolgirls talking about experiences of sexual violence and abuse, but partly because it seemed to me pragmatic. It seemed that the most obvious way to try and tackle the problem was to start somewhere where we could get everybody in a room before the point at which these attitudes became ingrained, and the obvious place to do that was at school. So for about 8 years, I went into around 2 schools a week on average, working with hundreds and thousands of young people from all different kinds of backgrounds all over the country and internationally. And of course, the responses were enormously varied. It wasn't always a walk in the park. Obviously, there was resistance and there were difficult conversations. But there was a marked and sinister shift in the last couple of years where suddenly I was experiencing a huge amount of resistance, of pushback, a very angry backlash from teenage boys. And they were coming pre-prepared. So they were arriving at talks believing that you were a hate-fueled feminazi who wanted to destroy men. They weren't able to listen or to engage whatsoever. And they had been indoctrinated with the same false statistics again and again. I would see in schools from an inner city state school to a rural boarding school, I would hear the same false statistics about, for example, false rape allegations being extraordinarily common, or the same feminist conspiracy theories that there was a feminist conspiracy at the heart of our government seeking to destroy the lives of white men who were the real victims in our society. And as these boys started parroting these specific statistics, and as they started repeating to me the names of the male leading lights, if you like, of these online communities, suddenly it fell into place for me that these boys were being radicalized, that they were being groomed online by these communities extremely successfully and cleverly. And at that point, suddenly the oxygen of publicity argument really kind of ceased to make sense, because actually at that point it seemed to me that it was quite useful for these communities that nobody knew who they were if they were managing to reach out and have such a huge impact on a generation of young men without any of the teachers or the parents or the governments in a position to support and prevent that from happening having any idea who those communities were.
So the manosphere, Laura, is something that you became aware of when it became apparent to you that there was a language and a set of statistics and arguing points that was common across all of these boys. What is the manosphere?
It's a loosely defined, interconnected network, if you like, of a number of different communities united really by a hatred of women. But although they're closely connected and they have a kind of complex ecosystem, they are quite distinct communities within there. So they range from so-called incels or involuntary celibates, men who believe that they aren't having sex because women deny it, because they believe that they have an inherent entitlement to sex as men. They believe that women should be punished for this denial of their sexual birthright, if you like. And they congregate and swap tips and advice on raping women on a day of retribution when they dream of incels rising up and massacring and murdering young women who fail to sleep with them. Then there are pickup artists. So the pickup artist industry globally is a $100 million industry that operates in almost every country in the world. world with absolutely no oversight, where in non-COVID times, in pretty much any major city in the world, a man can pay several thousand dollars on pretty much any given weekend to be trained in, if essentially sexually harassing and at worst sexually assaulting women, by an industry whose leading lights are men who have themselves boasted about rape, who have advocated that rape should be legalised on public property. And there is crossover in the belief systems of these different groups, but of course they have very different territory. Then you've got men going their own way. This is a group of men who believe women to be so toxic and dangerous and damaging that the only solution is to cut them out of your life altogether, which perhaps makes it sound rather niche or ridiculous. But in each of these cases, in each of the cases of the communities I'm describing, I've uncovered a complex network, a sort of ecosystem of blogs, websites, forums, communities, private social media groups, vlogs, channels, chat rooms, forums, and each of these, we're talking about each individual sort of link in the chain, if you like, often having membership numbering in the tens or hundreds of thousands of members, without taking into account the number of people who look at and consume this content without being a member. We're talking about a single one of these hundreds of websites having in the tens of millions of conversations and comments and chats going on. Then you've got men's rights activists, again, a distinct but connected group, who claim to care about men and their needs and problems affecting men, but in fact devote their time and energy exclusively to attacking and undermining women and feminism in particular, bringing lawsuits, trying to defund frontline sexual violence services, that sort of thing. And then you have trolls, a group which in some ways overlaps all of those, but in other ways is quite distinct. So those are the kind of specific groups that I identified, and the book looks at the different groups and at their overlaps with wider communities like white supremacists and the far right. I was very aware that these groups are extremely paranoid, and I knew that there would be very little success by sort of going in immediately and as myself. So I created a guy called Alex, who I tried to make the kind of really typical representation of everything I was seeing in these communities. So he was a college-educated, rather disaffected white man in his early 20s, unlucky in love, and with a sense of discomfort at the conversations going on around him about privilege, about various different civil rights movement, about the idea that he felt that in order for women to advance, somebody wanted to take something away from him. And he started out on the fringes of this stuff. He doesn't go straight to an incel forum because nobody does. He started out watching funny memes on Instagram meme accounts. He started out watching viral YouTube clips of people having debates. And he started out on Facebook groups and gaming live streams, and gradually sort of started picking up tidbits that led him to kind of quite generic websites where he started seeing slightly more in-depth messages and ideas about men being the real victims and how unfair, actually, that men were the ones who seemed to be getting all of this stick when he hadn't done anything wrong personally, and wasn't that really unfair? And why wasn't anybody thinking about how sexist it was to think that all men were like that, actually? And this was incredibly appealing because suddenly, instead of the position in society in which he saw himself as a bit of a loser, suddenly he wasn't a loser, he was an underdog. He wasn't unsuccessful, he was downtrodden. And here was this community of brothers in arms with experiences like his, ready to tell him that the whole world had been feeding him lies, and that actually he was the poor downtrodden underdog and he was a hero, and that they were brothers in arms on a crusade against a world stacked against them. And that was incredibly seductive because it provided him with this belonging, this sense of purpose and community that didn't necessarily exist for him elsewhere offline. And of course, it was very, very gradual. So at first, the misogyny was the odd joke or the odd meme. It was a meme about rape. It was just a joke. It was just banter. It was men blowing off steam. And it was so gradual over time, the drip, 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 that the communities and the online circles he was moving in became more and more extreme in their misogyny. And somewhere along the way, they stopped being jokes. But by the point at which that happened, he'd heard so many of them that he didn't really notice them anymore. And that is very much the process that was described to me by the former members of these communities that I interviewed for the book, this very, very gradual sense of desensitization and a very gradual form of drip, drip, drip radicalization until you reach the point where you're seeing hundreds of messages come up faster than you can watch them coming in about whether or not one guy should go and rape his friend's teenage sister, about another guy offering to sell to the highest bidder a pair of underwear that he's stolen from a woman that he knows, another posting a photograph of an unconscious woman without her consent or knowledge as a what's known online in these circles as a lay report. And suddenly it's just so much and you're so suffused in it that it almost isn't shocking anymore.
It shifts what normal is, right?
Absolutely, it shifts that perception. And some of the people who've left these communities who I spoke to said, I can see it now. Now I'm out, looking back in, now I can see it. But I don't know how to explain to you that at the time, it just didn't feel that way. In fact, there was one member of these communities, one incel, who at one point spoke to the national press to try and defend his brothers in arms. So passionately did he feel that this was really a positive men's community and it was being maligned. And he was bombarded with hate and threats, which he'd anticipated, but not from the place that he'd expected it to come from.
He'd expected it to come from feminists.
With abuse and vitriol, of course. Mm. And instead he was bombarded with abuse and vitriol from other men, from other incels, saying, why are you going out there saying that we don't mean it, saying that it's banter? We do want women to die. We do want to kill them. Stop telling the media that that's not what we're about.